Last year, 2018, the government met all its targets under the IMF agreement, 7% primary surplus, strong net international reserves, etc., etc. But the growth target, we were expecting to see us gradually move from 1% to 2% to 3% to 4% and ultimately arrive at the 5% mark by 2022. But where are we? Last weekend I went to Mobay and I was in the market. My stepmother, she had a shop in the market to sell clothes and shoes. And I was there with them for a while, just observing the play, and the police were there antagonizing the people, you know, it's going to be sold. You know, just a lot of cumbersome activities taking place. In the night when she came home, she said, "Dre, you really have to take a look at this man. You want to see about goods, fruits, and vegetables were left in our market after Saturday evening. Oh, then the people are going to make about them money. One, the farmer them from St. Louis, but borrow them money. Borrow money to buy the goods for come sell. Police antagonize them, they get to sell it. So how they more repay what them debt?" So that created in my mind an understanding of a very peculiar position that the country faces, which is we're not just affected negatively by drought and by flood. We are affected negatively by our pricing decisions, we are affected negatively by coordination of our municipal bodies, and we are affected negatively by post-harvesting and really making the best of what we produce. So with that said, we missed our 2.5% economic growth target last year, predominantly because of issues relating to agriculture, as well as slow start to the bauxite industry. And growth, Mr. Sharp titled the budget Stability, Growth, and Prosperity. In economics, we go stability, growth, and development. So, to some extent, it appears as if the prosperity has replaced the development, but the prosperity is benefiting from the development. So we're kind of taking a backward approach. We need to make sure that whatever stability we have, it leads to economic growth, and then whatever economic growth we have, we need to further economic development, and then it is from the development that we can enjoy the prosperity. 43,000 more jobs have been created according to the budget, and the unemployment rate has fallen from 13% to little over 10.4%. The government are raising more capital in the international market. Net international reserves are more than 700 billion beyond what we have calculated to be optimal. Now, the difference between actual and optimal reserves is that actual represents what the government has in their coffers at their disposal, while optimal refers to the amount that they really need to carry out their day-to-day business. Now, the optimal reserves that we've estimated were somewhere around 9% of GDP, you calculate that to be about 1.4 billion, while the actual reserves is way over 2.5 billion. Now, as you know, excess reserves beyond what is optimal is wasted capital that could have been infused in the economy to allow more economic activity. The same thing happened last year, October, I think, before I went to the IMF, there was some issue with the sterling amount. It was 30% and it was really draining too much foreign currency from the economy. We identified that, made the BOJ aware, they reduced it to 25%. Extra 5% release about 9 billion worth of additional foreign currency in the market, and we saw some pressure ease on the value of the currency because of the additional supply. So that how we mobilize capital is very important to how we mobilize economic activity and how we achieve our target. Now the government's objectives, and once again, last year the growth projection was 2.5%, this year the growth projection is 2.4%. I hope, the growth projection was 2.5% last year, it's 2.4% this year. I hope that this year, I heard you here with the tourist board advertisement, Jamaica is the best place to invest in, etc. We need to get it right. So it's not about the politics about yes, we want 5 and 4, and with the government this year we say we want the economy to grow by 5%. The next year we say we are not responsible for growth. It's about coordination. So we have to understand that these objectives, we want safer communities, higher standards of living, increased quality of life and opportunities for everyone. And all these beautiful stuff, improved roads and infrastructure, lower tax burden, stable exchange rate, all these things that we need requires coordination, it requires proper planning. Now, let's start with the expenditure. This year, total budget expenditure, is about 773 billion, and of that, non-debt expenditure is 484, and public debt servicing is about 289. So we've seen an increase in non-debt expenditure by 54 billion. If we want to take a closer look at the numbers, recurrent expenditure for 2018-2019 year is 560 versus 515 for 2017-18. But what we have to look at is capital expenditure, because that is where the economic activity takes place. And as you realize, capital expenditure for 2017-18 was about 290, while for 2018-19 is about 230. The total budget, these are the revised estimates I'm looking at, by the way, for 2017-18, I'm using the revised budget. And the total budget amount for 2017-18 was 805, and that amount has fallen to 773 because of what they call being fiscally responsible. Now, you must remember that Jamaica is operating on what we call a fiscal rule. And the fiscal rule mandates us to spend responsibly, so if there is no clearly outlined avenue for spending, then the government are restrained from spending. If you look at the table here, you see the purple, the total, the blue is the recurrent expenses, so you see a gradual slide slope, and then the capital is a up and down sort of movement. Now, an important aspect of this year's budget for me was the medium-term budget planning. Now, a criticism of the budget over the years, and I've criticized them a lot since 2012, is that we plan static budgets. So normally what you see is that the budget for one particular year outlines the expenditure items and revenues for that particular year. Now, this year we've seen a concerted effort to engage some sort of medium-term planning, where the government not only plan out expenditure for that specific year, but for 4 years in advance. And this makes it easier for them to prioritize items of spending per year. So this year you can say, alright, we'll fix some roads, next year we'll fix some schools, next year we'll fix some infrastructure, etc., etc. And what you see here is that we expect that recurrent expenditure will move to say 76% of the budget next year, and then back to 72% of the budget the following year. Capital B expenditure, and capital B for definition represents capital expenditure methods coming from our international partners, not from the government themselves, will remain at an average 6%, while capital A expenditure, which are capital expenditure coming from the government's budget, we move from 22% to 18% next year, and then back to 22% by 2021. Now, growth initiatives. The government has put a lot of their growth aspirations on agriculture and the bauxite industry. Funds have been earmarked, I see here, to build the Novak Head Technological Park. Now, I've extracted this from the budget and highlighted it because in order for us to achieve the level of growth that we want to have, we have to increase the value of what we produce. Now, when I teach students about GDP, we look at it from three different angles: supply side, demand side, production side. Now, growth in and within itself is that it looks at what the country is producing. If, for example, we're producing tomatoes, then our GDP, if we produce 10 pounds of tomatoes and they value $100 per pound, and our GDP for that particular year is $1,000. If there's another crop that fetches a higher value than a pound of tomatoes, then it makes sense for us to use the land to produce that anyway, because it is going to fetch us a higher value and it's going to allow our GDP to grow more. So technology plays an important role in our attempt to move the country forward. No country has been able to move from a point of underdevelopment to a point of development. Development is virtually possible in this world. And with the level of technology that is available to Jamaica and everybody of cell phone, whatever the case may be, we need to use these platforms more efficiently. So the funds for the Nagahead is welcomed, but we need to see a more concerted effort to integrate the technology more fulsomely into our day-to-day business environment. There's massive public sector transformation taking place, and they have highlighted national identity system as an avenue that they will be better able to integrate information across the country to make it better for people to have an understanding of where they need to participate. We cannot have economic expansion without improved roads and infrastructure. And $16.7 billion has been earmarked for road-related issues, the North-South Highway, the South Coast Highway, and a road to bypass Montego Bay. If any of you have visited Montego Bay over the last 3 months, or any of you have visited the inner city of Montego Bay, then you realize that the place is very run down, as you would call it. The inner city roads are dilapidated everywhere, not just in a few communities, everywhere. Now, I'm from Montego Bay, so I'm very passionate about what takes place there. And because we are considered the tourism capital of Jamaica, then I would expect that whatever infrastructure development are taking place within the city would involve making lives better for the people who service the tourism industry. Now, what we've realized in Jamaica is that a lot of public spending and a lot of grants and waivers go toward the tourism industry, but it goes to the owners. It goes to Spanish, Portuguese, Italian, whoever owns the hotel. But the people who provide services to the tourists are neglected. They have no pension, they're on contract. It's just a sad state. And you see, Jamaica is a slavery type economy where we don't really realize that the slavery business is not going to work. The young people, they are smarter than we are, and they will not waste their time on your slavery construct. They will try to create ways to increase their income outside of their family. Now, the budget has highlighted that they want to gradually transition businesses from the informal economy to the formal economy. But if there isn't facilities in place to ensure that small businesses get the same privileges as large businesses in all instances, then a lot of people will not be bothered to make that transition. So whatever the government is planning, it will determine, it will be dependent on their ability to help the grassroots move forward. The Ministry of National Security has been allotted 23.4% more than last year. It's moved from 63.6 billion to 78.5 billion, and this is important. A lot of new vehicles being purchased, etc., etc. But I'm from Mount Salem, and Mount Salem is where the first ZOZO, the Zone of Special Operation, was erected. Crime is something we can solve by police. You see? And you let me tell you, teacher, I will pay them in a teacher. So them have to do what we say. Speaking to the police. So you can buy 100 more vehicle, you can buy 200 more gun, you can buy whatever the case may be. Crime is a construct of many factors, and national security is just a cornerstone. It's not like it's a solution. So the issue is, the young people have been neglected, social infrastructure have been neglected, things to do to increase your income has been neglected. And I will say it again, and I cannot reiterate it more, the slavery approach to the economy will not work because the youths are watching BET and MTV, them see Lamborghini, them see this stuff, that is what they want. And like somebody who comfortable with nothing like that. Them need things to make them feel good. You have people who genuinely need things to make them feel good. Them need a house, they need a BMW, them need them things to make them feel good. And the young people are the same thing, they make them feel good. So them not really grow tomato. See, sometimes it's very difficult for us to understand what's taking place because of our point of view. You know? So coming from that point of view, I have to share that point of view with you. Wages. We have to look at wages. We have to look at wages. Everybody here learned from a teacher. I am a teacher. Who is self-learned? Put up my hand. Who is self-learned? Kingdom is a self-learned. Yeah, you're the animal. You know what they tell me? You're the animal now in school. So, self-learned. It's good. We don't make the elder. But apart from the elder, all of us learn from teachers. And we have to understand that they are people too. They are people too. And it is important. Back in the day, my teachers used to use extra lessons to subsidize their expenses. So, when I was going to primary school, every class had extra lessons. And if you don't get extra lessons, it costs anything to Africa. If you don't go, you're in a problem. Every day. So, when regular school done 2:30, my school done 5 o'clock, we have appealed for the extra lesson. Now, that is just to the side. Prep school students perform on average better, are expected to perform better and speak better English, whatever. Why? Because the teachers are better compensated. Private schools, the same thing. Teachers are better compensated. So they spend more time and energy trying to help the students to become better at what they do. Now, with Jamaica's situation, because the economy is positioned so oblong that a lot of the skill set that we equip our students with, the economy does not have the avenue to absorb those streams. So you have UWF, for example, turning out 500 lawyers, 200 accountants, 500 managers, 60 economists, while the economy cannot absorb those. So we are in a peculiar position, and as a country, we have to find our best to realize that a lot of the things that we put emphasis on, this cozy type of living, and the society type of life, and degree, and attitude, there are a lot of avenues that are equally as important and require equal amount of attention if we intend to move from a state of underdevelopment to a state of development. Spatial planning is one thing. Verb work. Nobody work in Kingston see the traffic in the morning. Nobody work in Kingston see the traffic in the middle of the day. Nobody work in Kingston see the traffic at 5 o'clock. It's very poor. The same thing in Montego Bay. I was there on Friday. About an hour of the rainfall. The car flooded out. I'm stuck in a parking lot for about 3 hours. It's a joke. So we have massive expansion going on in Google without proper infrastructure. So all these are just nonsense. So this is for politics that we are playing, and then our friends can do whatever they feel like. It's like a joke, so you don't know how to do it. You understand what I'm saying? So the crime issue is as a result of our overall approach. The government has successfully negotiated wages with JUTC, junior doctors, senior doctors in certain categories, but the teachers have been involved. Fiscal stability targets. No, debt servicing has fallen from 46% to 37% of the budget. Government can access funds from the IMF on standby insurance purposes. This year's budget is smaller than last year and consolidated because of fiscal responsibilities, and our primary surplus is on target. Jamaica's credit rating has improved significantly by most of the rating agencies, Moody's, Standard & Poor's, Fitch, and so on, which means that the government is fetching cheaper loans from the international market as well as from the domestic market. Now, what interest rates have the government witnessed? The government has witnessed a treasury bill rate of 6.1%, treasury bill rate less term with 3.5, a low of 3.2%. The BOJ signal rate is somewhere about 3.75, it has dropped to 2.75%. And we still have low private sector credit to GDP ratio. It's about 24%. But if you want a loan to buy a car, if you want a loan to buy a house, which is important, you can get it. But business helps the economy to move forward. I know business is very uncertain. As Armin said, it's very easy to open a business, but it's very difficult to continue business. It's just the politics in business. We have to take a more serious approach. Now, the government is fetching a lower interest rate. But the banks are hurting the profits. Well, why? You know that the economy does not grow because we do not have indigenous investment. A revelation from my book, I think it's chapter 7, we look at foreign direct investment and its impact. And because most of the profits are repatriated, the business interest is moving on a gambling, it's like you're buying a stock to make a money today. That's how these international businesses operate. So they come to Jamaica on the favorable terms. And as soon as those favorable terms are withdrawn, they leave very quickly. Very quickly. So we need indigenous capital to help the economy grow. And the banks, you are the lifeline of the economy. You are like the veins that help pump the blood, which is that money. Very important. Interest rate spreads are around 16% on average last year, the difference between the lending and the deposit rate, that is your profit. We love profit, but at the same time, I like to see economic activity. The banks must continue to play a role to reduce rates and to help businesses expand. Anti-money laundering issues needs to be addressed in order to maintain our correspondence banking relationships. Jamaica, last time I checked, we were trying to implement Basel II. And the world is at Basel IV. So the BOJ also has to play a role there. Move our financial regulatory framework on par with international standards. Jamaica want to attract capital. I hear I've been sending out in tours about advertisement to attract capital. We have to move our regulatory framework forward. MSMEs and financial inclusion, very important. We shun MSMEs because they have no collateral, sometimes they have no business plan, they have no financial statements, most of them just have an idea. Now, business support is important. Business support is necessary, and business support must be direct. We have to understand that there are a lot of businesses in Jamaica. I've never been anywhere and seen people so entrepreneurial as Jamaican people. We prefer sell ice a minute and make a dollar a day than for work for somebody and make $1,000 a day. Most of us. So we have to understand that the bank must also have to provide these support services to help these businesses move forward. These ideas where they can be collaborated and pulled together, we must provide those business services. Say, look, Jantown, Mary and Jane also have a similar idea like this, that I think if the three of you collaborate, then you will be able to put this idea more into perspective and have a more sustainable business. And that is the basis upon which the Grameen system worked in Sri Lanka. There were the loans that were given in clusters. That means that five people are responsible for everybody else to pay back that particular loan. So it's not on one person to say, all right, John, you know, say borrow $1 million and I want to back by tomorrow. More four other people. John, what happened to the million that I borrowed? If you don't pay back your million, I can't pay back my million. And it's a circular winding process. So we need to think outside of the box and look at other examples of how lending streams have worked across the world and how they are coordinating borrowing to move things forward. Tax compliance, greater tax collection efforts were made last year and the government collected more than expected. Even though the tax rate fell with an expansion of the PAYE, then you realize that on that basis they would expect to collect less, but they end up collecting more, which is very good. And it is important for us to understand that we must continue to pay taxes. Finally, the finances budget. The first time I've been tracking the budget since 2012 every year, and every year 7% tax on oil. 7% tax on gas at the pump, tax on the phone card, tax on everything, tax on bank fees, this, that, one of the nonsense. This year, we have no new tax measures, which is welcome. No new tax measures. Even though the government has planned to spend $773 billion, they only plan to collect $700 billion in revenues. So I say, no, then this is a balanced budget. It's like, where does the balance come from? So I called them down there to find out. So I want to sell the budget balance. I want to plan to collect $700 million. I plan to spend $773 million. So them tell me, say, it's an estimate, and then if them will make, well, like them say, if them will make the money for the other $73 million, then I'm going to buy that spending. So then I said, when are we going to sell it? Like, when are we going to sell it? All right, this $700 million guarantee for spend, and then next $73 million. So what areas are you going to cut? It's not like cutting, it's just where the money stops with pop up. Serious thing, No. If you look at where we plan to get our revenue from, yeah, so we're always going to find ourselves in problems with an approach like that. Because I did an accounting degree, so I knew balance of 700 and 700. This year we plan to collect $518 billion in taxes, other non-tax revenue, $60 billion. Capital revenue 16, grants 9, and loans 103. The important thing for you to look at here is the loans. Because we want a budget where that amount is constantly falling, the amount that we borrow to repay them. So, because of our medium-term debt strategy, we have been gradually trying to reduce our debt. And the amount, because Jamaica practices to borrow to pay debt, is like, you know, they call them like a pay the loan thing. So this week you're broke, you borrow money, you spend it. Next week you borrow money for pay back the loan. So Jamaica was caught up in that sort of scenario as well. So we're gradually coming out of it, and it is very, very important. Revenue measures here, if you look at them from a graphical point of view, you realize that's taxation across different years, non-tax revenue, capital grants, and so on. So that's just a graphical illustration. And we have a debt-to-GDP ratio that's falling, and this was highlighted by Albin as well as Constant and the other panelists, and it's very important for us to what we call free up fiscal space in the budget. And this will allow us to increase capital spending. Now, concluding remarks. The government has come a far way to achieve macroeconomic stability necessary to achieve economic growth, which if used efficiently can increase the level of development in an ongoing mining process. That's how it works. And we've benefited a great deal from the fiscal rule, and we should continue with it. And we've benefited a great deal from this year for no new taxes. I was surprised. Please, Bob, tell them to continue with that promise. Don't make me really say, oh, and we made an error. We are putting tax on fuel, 70 cents per liter. We don't want to see that. This year we want a break, man. We are on the right side of the laugh of curve. So we need a break. If a country expenses become prosperous, the quality of jobs is important, or equally important as the quantity of jobs. Medium-term planning is good, but long-term planning is best. Thank you.